Hey everybody, I thought we'd talk a little bit today about rhythmic intent, specifically breaking down rule 4.2.2, which states, no single triggered electronic sound may produce rhythmic intent. This is one of the shortest, I believe it is the shortest rule in our rule book. So on the face of it, it seems very easy to understand and very easy to interpret. Unfortunately, this seems to give a lot of groups a lot of problems when they get to events with misinterpretations and misunderstandings of the intent of this rule and what it's there for. So I'd like to take a little bit of time to break that down today. The advisory board has interpreted this rule and created this rule basically to protect something very important to the activity. And that's that we want all music performed to be performed live in real time by the performers on the floor. We don't want anything that is pre-recorded and pre-canned that is, you know, basically a standalone piece of music to be triggered with one attack in a show. Something to the effect of, you know, a bossa nova patch where we hit it once and then we just kind of drum along with it, or we're playing along with a click track or a loop or something like that. We don't want that at all. We want the activity to be grounded in education and in teaching percussion, and integral to that is the rhythmic structure of the music that we're performing. It's just a fundamental part of percussion. So this rule exists basically to protect that as part of what it is that we do. I have an example that I'd like to share with you today. Let's pretend for a second that our show is going to feature a piece of music. Let's say we're going to use Superstition by Stevie Wonder, and I want to show you how we would go about utilizing this in the show and what will work and what will not work, what could get you in trouble with this rule. So here is just a quick little clip of part of the music that we would want to then score for our percussion ensemble. So if this were going to be a portion of my show, what I would want to do is take this and I'd orchestrate it for my percussion ensemble. We'd have all sorts of different instruments playing all sorts of different roles in here, but somewhere in here I would want to have the melodic content, the very superstitious part, performed by one of the instruments. I could do that with a vibe, I could do that with marimba, with glock, I could do that with a lot of different instruments. But when I go to break that down and start to orchestrate it, it is six different notes to be able to perform back that phrase. Very superstitious. It's going to be six notes to perform that back. If I score that for vibe, it's six notes. For marimba, it's six notes. For glock, it's six notes. I can also score that for guitar or synth. And if I score it on synth, I can play it back with a piano patch or a string patch or a trumpet patch. Several years ago, with the advent of more advanced workstations and sampling tools and things like that, we started to have several designers that said, hey, if I can play this back with a trumpet patch, couldn't I also have my performer play it back with a Stevie Wonder patch? Couldn't I also take an a cappella version of this and sample it back and basically, you know, play those same six notes, but instead of, you know, strings coming out of the synth, we're going to be triggering actual samples of Stevie Wonder? And the answer, of course, is yes. Functionally, it's exactly the same. We're still teaching the same skills. We're still having the performers responsible for performing the same content in your show. And if you can find a way to break that up and sample it up and just program a, you know, your own custom Stevie Wonder patch on your synth instead of a string patch, by all means do it. So we would kind of break it down into this. Here is just the Stevie Wonder patch all by itself, the a cappella version. Very superstitious. Once again, that phrase is still six notes long. So whether I'm playing it back on vibes or marimba or synth, whether I'm doing it with a string patch, a trumpet patch, or a Stevie Wonder patch, it's got to be a six note phrase. I'm going to have to perform that back as six discrete sounds. So with the advent of samplers and synth workstations and multi-pads and things like that, I can break this up and have performers perform this live in real time as part of my full musical score, but again, it's got to be six notes. Here's where we see people run into problems. They will put this into a sampler of choice and they will hit one pad and this is what we'll hear. Very superstitious. That's in clear violation of this rule. You just played back a bar of music and you only played one whole note in essence. If you were to have done the exact same thing on vibes and struck one bar, the audience clearly would not have heard the song Superstition. You can't basically invoke this piece of music without six notes in a very specific harmonic pattern with a very specific rhythmic structure. And we're going to have to do the same thing with our sampler as well. So this does not work as a one note sample. We also see, unfortunately, a lot of people go, well, I broke up my samples. I heard Very and I heard Superstitious, so I broke it up into two samples. And once again, that's inadequate. I want you to think of it this time and think of just triggering the sampler on Very and Superstitious. Very superstitious. So I, in essence, just played back two quarter notes, and if I had done that on the vibes and I just struck the beginning of Very and the beginning of Superstitious, we still don't have the song Superstition. The only way we have that piece of music is with six distinct samples, six distinct notes, and that's got to be the same no matter what instrument we're using. So when you're taking a piece of source material and you're taking something that already exists in the real world and you're chopping it up, it's got to be chopped up into each individual note. Some pieces of music are very easy to do this with. Some are very complex. I would dare say that some pieces of music are even impossible to do it. There's no way you'd be able to get that thing sampled that tightly and have somebody play it back flawlessly enough for it to be believable. So if you're going to go down that route in your show, make sure that you're picking source material that you, A, can get, you know, a clean enough sample of, and then B, that you can splice it up and cut it up enough so that they're playing it back in functionally the same way that they would if you were orchestrating that for one of the melodic percussion instruments in your percussion ensemble. So that portion is the easy portion to understand. The more difficult portion is this next one. All right, now let's dive into a more complicated portion of Rule 4.2.2, and that's the way that this rule has implications for all sorts of different audio devices in our show. The modern percussion show consists typically of things that are more than just the musical portion. We have a whole lot of groups now that have done a lot of experimentation in the last decade plus with spoken word and narration and sound effects and environmental soundscapes and things of that nature. And I want to break down how some of these things factor into this whole idea of rhythmic intent. The analogy that I like to use here is to pretend that our indoor percussion shows are movies. If we were looking at a movie, the audio profile of that movie would be established to three different components. One would be the film score, the original composition, the music that goes with it. Another completely separate role would be the Foley artists that are creating the background sounds, the footsteps, the gunfire, the busy New York streets, things like that. And then the third component of the audio profile would be the actor's job, the spoken word, the narrative that kind of moves the story along. We've already dealt with our film score portion of this. We already talked about how the music has to be performed live in real time by the performers on the floor. Let's deal with the spoken word portion for a segment. It used to be that you either had to speak live on the floor, or that if you wanted to use a famous speech or something like that, you had to break it up literally syllable by syllable. And a number of years ago, the advisory board reversed the ruling on that, and wisely so, I think. It was mostly done for production value purposes. We were having wonderful, famous, historic speeches that were being completely butchered by all these weird little syllable breakup things, and it made for shows that were not very intriguing and not very captivating. And I think the advisory board wisely looked at this and said, look, the holy grail is still that we perform music live in real time. Does allowing a pre-recorded version of of Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech, does that infringe upon students' responsibility to perform music live in real time? It really doesn't. So at that point, they allowed spoken word to be one single trigger can trigger an entire speech. Because that's utilized just as a background component to a show. It's kind of an accessory piece to the show. Yes, it moves the show forward. Yes, it kind of moves the plot along, but that was not the key fundamental music component that we spend most of our time evaluating and adjudicating and comparing and contrasting. So spoken word, totally legal. Use as much of it as you'd like. Be very, very creative with it. We love to see stuff. Where it gets a little weird is in the middle ground. When we talk about the Foley artists, when we talk about the sound effects that you're going to utilize in their show, there are some sound effects that are totally legal. There are other sound effects that are illegal. What determines the difference between those two things are the context in which they're used. So we've got all sorts of sound effects. We could have waves crashing on a beach. We could have footsteps. We could have a heartbeat. We could have busy New York streets. We could have background jungle noises or something like that. And they all come with different contexts. So I've got an example here. This is a train passing in the background. I want to play this sample for you, and then we'll talk about whether it's legal or illegal. So the answer for this is that it's neither legal nor illegal. It depends on how it's utilized in the show. It depends on the context. If your show is going along and a piece of music ends, and then you are trying to establish a new atmosphere, it's a busy, crowded train station, we've got trains coming in and trains coming out, it's clearly a background sound. It's a sound effect. It creates the ambiance or the atmosphere there. And there is no problem with triggering this with one single sample because of the way that you intend to use this, because of the rhythmic intent. You're not intending the rhythm of the train. It's just a Foley sound. It's atmospheric. If, on the other hand, you use this exact same sample and you trigger this with one button, and then you begin to mark time along with it, or you begin to drum along with it, or this sets up the rhythmic structure for your next piece of music. Now the rhythm of that train in the background does have a clear intent to influence the musical program. So we have basically taken the sample out of the background Foley art realm, and we've integrated it into our musical production. It is now part of the score. It is part of what is driving the show forward from a musical perspective. So when we get into some of these samples, yes, it's difficult, and yes, there is some gray area between them. What you always want to remember is this being used just for atmosphere? Is this just a sound effect background? Or is this part of my musical score? If it's part of the music that we're communicating to the audience, if it's part of the musical production, it's got to be performed live in real time by the performers. I hope this video clip has been helpful for you. It's certainly a very important rule. It's something that seems to trip a lot of people up, and I really do think it's just a lot of misunderstandings of what the rule is and misinterpretations of it. One of the best things that I can say to do is to come up with a segment in your show and ask around, ask people, is this legal, is this illegal? If you get a lot of people that say, definitely that's out of bounds, you know you got to change it. If everybody says that's definitely in bounds and you've broadcast it to enough people, you're probably good to go. If it's something where it's coming down in between and you're not ever sure, you can always kick it up to a circuit administrator at your local level or even a WGI administrator and have us take a look at it. Remember, again, the context matters a whole lot. Not if it's part of the music. If it's part of the music, it's got to be performed live in real time. But there are certain sound effects and things you can do where the context matters, and you can't just, you know, take an MP3 and go legal or illegal. It depends on how it's integrated into the show. And that's why really we focus this rule not on sampling, so to speak, but on single triggered electronic sounds producing rhythmic intent. What is the intent of that sound in your show? Is it intended to be part of the music, or is it intended to be part of the background? Thank you very much for watching.